Searching for extraterrestrial intelligence in radio suffers from a very serious problem that's far worse than usual in radio astronomy in general. One is we have no idea where to point the radio telescope. Most of the galaxy's several hundred billion stars could host inhabited planets and civilizations, but in our position, we have no idea which one. So it's just a process of careful elimination as you look star to star. The biggest challenge from there being that you have to catch the signal when the aliens are transmitting, or you'd never know it was there. So you have that problem. SETI really is a shot in the dark process, one after one, hoping for luck. There is hope for something better, however, more on that in a bit. But even if you did know where to look, there's a further problem, a big one. The number of possible radio frequencies in nature is extremely high, ridiculously so, and aliens could be transmitting on any one of them across the radio area of the spectrum, and we have no idea where to look. It's not unlike broadcast radio. If you're trying to tune in to an AM or FM station, it's easy. You just tune into the station's frequency number. If you're surfing the dial, it's a bit harder, but you'll probably find something. But it's more challenging. But you have only a tiny part of the spectrum to search. SETI has much, much more to sift through. So we have no idea which one to tune into on the dial. There are ways of getting past that to a degree. You can chop the frequencies up into general channels, many millions of them in SETI, and search them all simultaneously, which SETI does these days with modern equipment. But there are still areas of the radio spectrum where this really isn't done. This is actually an aspect of SETI that doesn't make a huge amount of sense on its face. So the assumption has always been that aliens would emit radio at frequencies similar to our own. Look for what you know, and the frequencies that we use are perfectly good for what they do. That's why we use them. But the strange thing here is that it's always been partial. We don't actually search the whole span of human communication and radio. We do actually use the frequencies SETI generally wasn't looking at. SETI tends to look at signpost frequencies, such as the 21 centimeter line, in hopes of some anchor point aliens might actually transmit at. These frequencies host signals created by nature, such as neutral hydrogen. So if we know nature does that, aliens with radio telescopes do as well, and might choose to send contact signals at or near one of those frequencies. SETI also does shot-in-the-dark searching around frequencies that we use, though some of those are so flooded with interference that they are difficult to search, but not all of them, and there's a reason. Searching washed-out frequencies very carefully is going to ultimately require a radio telescope built on the far side of the moon. That may seem like a far future proposition, but there are actually ideas floating around to make use of the fact that lunar craters are, well, very roughly shaped like radio telescope dishes. If you could deploy a robotic probe or a group of probes, you could use that natural bowl shape to deploy a foldable radio telescope dish inside without the need to actually have a human present. An interesting idea to be sure, and wouldn't just benefit SETI but radio astronomy in general. But here on Earth, past searches have focused overwhelmingly on frequencies above 600 MHz, with the lower frequencies only very rarely looked at. Well, not only do we use those lower frequencies in air traffic control and marine broadcasting, such as very low frequency communications with submarines, it also includes AM and FM radio. That's right, we aren't looking for our own commercial radio stations. Many interviews and articles by SETI researchers often cite that we're listening for alien radio stations, but they rarely mention that if aliens were listening to the same frequencies SETI was, they wouldn't pick up Earth's radio stations. But there's a practical reason for why this happened. One is high interference, but also radio stations and things like that are picked up by antennas and receivers because they are transmitting very strongly here on Earth. There are some AM stations in the US, for example, known as clear channel stations, that can broadcast at 100,000 watts at certain times of the day, and if the ionosphere is just right, can sometimes be heard out in the Pacific Ocean or further. But at a distance, this is complicated because lower frequency radio waves have less energy, which means they are harder to detect with what SETI is doing in upper frequencies. They are already listening for incredibly weak signals by their nature. It's a stretch to go weaker in the past amid so much interference. The other problem is that standard radio telescopes are not quite the same thing as an antenna on handheld radio. They are telescopes, and there really weren't any specialized instruments until recently that could routinely search these regions of the spectrum. The equipment wasn't usually built for it. But that's changed. We now have telescopes that can. One such low-frequency array in operation since 2019 is known as LOFAR, or the Low-Frequency Array. The individual components of the interferometer array are located in multiple countries in Europe, and actually are antennas, 52 of them right now and growing, that when used together actually are very high resolution and can cover a very wide field of view. LOFAR has been extremely successful as a scientific instrument. It can probe the reionization of neutral hydrogen in the aftermath of the Big Bang. This is thought to have happened in the epoch of the formation of the first stars and galaxies. But the emissions of the neutral hydrogen, the famous 1420 megahertz hydrogen line, or 21 centimeters again, will actually redshift down into the range of LOFAR because of the distance and the expansion of the universe. Moreover, it yields clues on early galaxy formation, and is even important in studying coronal mass ejections from the Sun, but it also does SETI. Recent work with LOFAR, or parts of it actually, looked at 44 known exoplanets that had been identified by NASA's test spacecraft. They were looking at between 110 and 190 megahertz, but because of the lower frequency searching method, it actually included about 36,000 potential radio sources. Nothing was detected, but further searching is planned. But this still comes up against a major challenge, which is worse than an already challenged SETI landscape. Interference is insane at these low frequencies due to heavy human use, so teasing out interesting signals is that much harder. This would be really difficult to do with a single radio telescope. Interference entering it is just that. But if you have an interferometer like LOFAR, you can actually look at each of the individual telescopes and determine which of the telescopes are picking up the same interference and where, allowing for a way to weed through the signals to some degree. Other ongoing surveys cover the 30 to 85 megahertz range now as well. But again, there's an issue here that also plagues all of SETI. Where to look and when? Currently, no radio telescope can spend 100% of its time looking at the same target. This would make sense to do, but it's just not feasible. Even with dedicated mostly to SETI arrays like the Allen Telescope Array, they can only spend a few hours at a time per target, typically a star system, and then move on. Obviously, if aliens happen to not be transmitting at that exact time, we'd never see it. The only way to fix this in a targeted SETI search is to build a 24/7 radio telescope fixed on a star, and that's not likely to happen until after we find a really good candidate. If we do ever find that candidate, however, it's a virtual certainty that it will be monitored 24/7 as we try to figure out that signal. But as it stands, the hope, of course, is that aliens act like us and emit a constant stream of radio across many different areas of the dial. That would be ideal. We are present at most frequencies, and we're not that narrowband. Things bleed from the technology even when you're trying to very efficiently transmit to save energy. But other than in a few specific cases, we don't emit very high energy signals that would be detectable at a distance, and what we do emit that could be seen is transient, they typically do not repeat. The aliens wouldn't see us all of the time, thus they'd have to either monitor Earth constantly, or at least frequently enough, to have a real chance of seeing us because most of what we're producing isn't going to make it to them at the strength they can detect. And what we really did blast out did not repeat, such as the famous Arecibo signal. Then if Alien SETI works on the same rules as ARDS does, those signals would be considered wow signals at best, or they'd miss them completely because their telescope wasn't pointed in the direction at the right time. And to do any of this, the aliens would need to be within about 100 light-year radius of Earth. Our transmissions have not yet propagated out very much further than that, and none of the strong signals have. That's asking a lot for others to have detected us yet. Yet someday that will not be the case. Every year, more and more star systems become capable of hearing us. Each year, the numbers grow. Right now, it's a bit over 10,000 stars. In 100,000 years, less than the time our species has existed on Earth, it will be in principle, with a big enough radio telescope, for all of the Milky Way's hundreds of billions of stars to see us. I think it would be a true shame if the civilizations of the Milky Way were watching our radio and then saw it end, concluding that we succumbed to extinction before they ever got a chance to meet us in person. But we may make it, and alien civilizations may be far older than we are, and may have been transmitting continuously for thousands of years. Well, in this case, SETI is favored, because if aliens do indeed do that, then the galaxy is only 100,000 light years across, so that leaves a lot of time for continuous signals to have propagated all throughout the galaxy. Specific contact signals are in a worse state, however. The original Cocconi and Morrison paper that kicked SETI off many decades ago envisioned huge beacons announcing the existence of civilizations in all directions. This was looked for and not found. No one in the galaxy appears to be doing it in an easily detectable way, which led SETI to more nuanced and focused searches. But with directed signals, they may not be on all the time, which means we could easily miss them. The WOW signal may have been one such signal. It hasn't repeated, but we also haven't been looking for it 24/7, far less in fact. So how might we solve this issue and look more broadly? The solution involves all-sky SETI surveys, where you look at the entire sky, preferably all the time or as much as you can, which dramatically increases your chances of catching a signal, at least a strong one. There have been experiments with systems of this type, such as the Ohio Argus Array, which hasn't detected anything, but it's still an area that needs further development and improvement. As an aside, all-sky SETI actually has its origin in science fiction. In his book, Imperial Earth, Arthur C. Clarke envisions a telescope, also called Argus, that illustrates that it's actually really important to try to do all-sky constant surveys, specifically because of the Great Silence. So far as we can tell, the Milky Way appears perfectly natural, with no evidence of alien civilizations within it other than ourselves. This may be suggestive of something. It may be that alien civilizations are simply rare, which was one of the points Clarke made in the book, and could be reasonably expected. If that's the case, then searching star to star for aliens is not likely to find anything, and it may well be that the reason we haven't found anything thus far. You'd have to look at tens of thousands or more star systems at just the right time, or 24/7 for a very long time, to make a detection. All-sky SETI experiments, however, can more efficiently keep an eye out for rare or transitory signals much better than directional dishes can. Clarke also noted that this is also applicable if using radio is only a phase alien civilizations go through before abandoning it for some other means of communication. Even if detectable civilizations are common, they always stand a better chance of being older than we are, and if technological, more advanced. It's unlikely to see too many civilizations exactly at your level of technology when you only started using radio just a bit more than a century ago. So given that, you want to look at as many star systems as you can simultaneously to raise your chances of catching civilizations at your stage in development. Clarke also envisioned locating his all-sky radio telescope in space and making it an absolutely enormous array. This would have many advantages, of course, and building a huge array of small launchable telescopes is something we could do today, though admittedly at great expense on the scale that Clarke envisioned. But the bottom line really is, there are areas of radio that we have yet to meaningfully look for alien signals, and we haven't looked long enough. So it's really not remarkable that we have yet to find a rock-solid candidate. The search in many ways has only just begun. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently addressing a common comment I get from the people. JMG, why aren't any of your books available as audiobooks? All you do is talk on YouTube. Surely you could record them. Listen to Anna and the Possum. You're being silly. Get them out there. Well, here's the story. I can definitely make them available on Audible and other formats, but I want to do two things. The first is that for probably obvious reasons, I intend to narrate them myself in my voice. And two, it just takes a huge amount of time to block off to record them. And the video release cadences here and at Event Horizon don't leave a lot of time left in the day. A typical script on this channel is about 2,500 words or so. Novels are over 80,000 words, so it's a big investment in time, but with any luck, it'll happen in 2025. And be sure to check out my print or ebooks at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.